Right, what does it mean when the Lord says, I will go before thee, make the crooked places straight, rather, I will send my angel to go before thee and make the crooked places straight. And we all get to remind us the Bible, I am the Lord God, I deliver thee. That was the mantra back then. Remember, I delivered you from the Pharaoh. You didn't do anything. I did it. I fed you. I redeemed you. I removed your reproach. I destroyed your enemies before your enemies. Same thing with Joshua's generation. Lord, parted, it says the Lord parted the Red Sea. He parted the Jordan so that the children of Israel could cross over to the promised land, carrying the Ark of the Covenant. And the first battle of Jericho, the walled city, city with fortifications. They were to march around the city 7 days. Blow the trumpet and let the people know that the Lord is here. Our God is with us. Look at that sermon. Look at this. That verse. Same thing with the Battle of Ai. They had some difficulties. Because they were defeated. And how were the children of Israel defeated? Handily defeated by something that could have should have easily been a victory, an easy victory, easy win. They lost. And if you look into what happened in their defeat, one of their members had violated the commandment of the law. Joshua had informed the people that we rout this city. We're going to not take any spoil, destroy everything. Man, woman, child, beast, everything. But one of the members had took it upon themselves to take a little something, you know, Lord ain't, don't mind, you know, it's this little thing, you know, I took this, took that. Yeah, I know the Lord said thus and so and this and thou. What is this little bit going to hurt? This little taste. What is this little taste going to hurt? Well, this little taste caused the whole congregation of the children of Israel to become defeated before their enemies, before easy victory, easy. And Joshua, his reaction, he heard the news. The Lord, he went before the Lord, sackcloth and ashes. Lord, what's going on? I mean, you're defeated. I don't know, Lord, where you at? Please, Lord, begging and pleading. Prayer. Oh, Lord, what's going on? And Lord said, son, don't worry. It'll be all right. Problem is, thus and so. And since thus and so is the issue in your congregation, I am not with you. As you have violated what I said to do. You didn't do. You, those attached to you, under your leadership, what I'm pointing out to you as a leader is this is the issue. And you need to take care. Lord, how you want me to go about taking care of it? You want to take care of it? Everything gonna be all right. What does my law say? The law of Moses? A thief? Violator of God? Hiding? Well, we don't need to go necessarily go into the details of the law. Let's see what they did. How they got eradicated this back then. They brought the whole assembly together and they used their efforts and worms and durums, cast lots, upon all the 12 tribes. And the 12 tribe and the tribe that the issue was in showed up, and then the smaller division showed up, and then the division showed up on their lots. And they were shaking them with their lots, choosing their lots in prayer to the Lord, God of all earth. And this man came up and he confessed. But back then it was a little too late. They were a warring people. They had to overcome. We got some overcomers in here. Warriors. And the sentence was passed. And this man who had taken some gold, little trinket here, and other little valuable token, hid in his tent. His violation of the word of the Lord affected his family in a most drastic of ways. The congregation gathered up the man, gathered up his wife, his daughter, the Bible says, son, daughter, his cattle, his tent, all of his belongings, their belongings, their livestock. And put them in the valley. They stoned them to death and burnt them alive, or burnt them. They removed the iniquity, the wickedness from their midst, according to the directions of the Lord. They removed, cleansed the iniquity and wickedness from amongst the midst, their midst. We necessarily don't do that anymore. We're under Jesus. We have a new covenant. And under Jesus, when we're in the valley of Achor, as they say, there's a door of hope. Back then, he didn't have hope. Achor. In the valley of Achor, he didn't have a door of hope. There was no hope for him back then. But we have hope. And hope is Jesus. We have hope in Jesus. That if we be confessed, we can be forgiven. And we can be cleansed. And we can be reinstituted, redeemed. To our former glory, our former status and position of righteousness in the eyes of the Lord through Jesus. That's what's so special about Jesus. In our valleys, and all of us have our valleys, some more than others, but it doesn't matter. When you're in the valley of your shame, there is a door of hope, and his name is Jesus. But let us go on. Get back to Joshua and the congregation. After they cleansed, that cleansing they had is like the cleansing, the washing that priests had to go through to be meet for the master's use. When Moses would consecrate the priest, he would offer burnt offering for their sins. And then he would move over to the bronze ladle and wash. They were chosen vessels. Consecrated, but their sins had been forgiven by the burnt offering covered. But they needed to be washed, cleansed. And that was the daily thing, the cleansing of the priests to be meet for the master's use. Yes, your sins are forgiven, but you must have a cleansing. And then we can take a look at Jesus, the washing of the feet. And with Jesus, he objected, "No, Master, Jesus," after they had supper, he took up his girdle. And he removed his priestly garments, wrapped a towel, girded himself with the towel. Actually, you could even say and understand this as he added on the extra priestly garments. He removed his flowery, regal priestly garments and put on his work boots. Put on his gloves, and he went to his daily tasks. But what some may seem as drudgery, menial, but the cleansing of his disciples' feet, the washing of their feet. They were already chosen. They were already forgiven. But they needed this other daily thing of cleansing of their feet. Because where they had been walking, they had picked up filth. They had picked up dirt. They had touched unclean things that they needed cleansing. Because, as Jesus said, if I do not wash your feet, Peter, or feet, Peter, you have no part with me. You're not any good for me to use. You're not cleansed. Yes, you're forgiven. Yes, grace. Grace has forgiven you. And grace now goes on to cleanse you of the filth that you picked up in your sojourning in the earth. It's filthy. Oftentimes our sojourning in the earth is filthy. Trespass, unbeknownst to us, or transgressed beyond with our full knowledge and weakness. So therefore we need cleansing. And we need grace for cleansing, and we need grace for forgiveness of our outright sins and sins. But Joshua went on to victory after they cleansed themselves of their wickedness. And the lesson that the people learned, and the lesson that we should learn today from that example, is the necessity for our cleansing.
It is always of a great benefit to revisit the Old Testament, some of the stories that are present therein, because what we see from this account of Joshua and the children of Israel, the sin of Achan, the valley of Achor, and what occurred during that situation was the sin of one man utterly destroyed his entire family. His transgressions affected the success of the organization that he was a part of. He was the weak link in the chain, in the strength of the organization. And the sin of that member, the leader, the head of the family, caused destruction to fall upon all of the family members, the son, the daughter, his wife, his home, his cattle, his oxen, and all of his possessions were utterly destroyed in the Valley of Achor. And that's why, brothers and sisters, we must be mindful. Although we are under the new covenant, a covenant of grace, a covenant of mercy, we still must be mindful and make evaluations whether or not we are in the faith of Jesus Christ, whether our actions are bearing fruit, that we are saved, that we are Christian, and that we are children of God. Also, in the ministry efforts and the pulpits of the churches, there must be a presentation of the law, not necessarily a stoning that occurred in the Valley of Achor. The stoning of the people is not necessary, but a clear understanding of the godly standard of a Christian people must be presented. And therefore, the law of Moses, the law of our God, is a memorial. The stones were often placed as memorials for the children of Israel and for future generations to remember God's standard. Therefore, a memorialization of the law and a bringing the people to a remembrance of the godly standard, along with a fiery presentation from the pulpits of Christian churches, representing the judgment of our God, as a reminder of the damaging and destroying effects of just a little sin, can have not only on the individual, but on the families of the individuals, of the lives and success of the organization and the group that they belong to. So today, brothers and sisters, we don't have to go through the tragedy of Achan and his family. We have this historic example as a testimony to the damaging effects of sin. And it should not be forgotten in the minds of Christians. This is a great work for Christians to meditate upon, to change their heart, to see the error of their ways, and make the necessary changes under this covering of grace that we have in the New Testament and under the new covenant of Jesus Christ. There is a door of hope. And the door of hope is the grace that the Lord allows for us to walk in when we find ourselves in the valley of our shame, in the valley of our decision and judgment, rather than face the utter destruction and the fiery judgment of the Lord. We have grace, a door of hope and grace to walk through with full repentance and full humbleness in our shame of the error of our ways and the sins of our hands. Brothers and sisters, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit.